Couple years of up all night and a few thousand diapers later, that mistake he thought he made covers up the refrigerator. Oh yeah, he loves that little girl.
My name is Clay Holderman, and Pastor Dan asked if I would help dive into the life of Joseph today. We're going to do so in Matthew 1, starting in verse 18, if you want to go there in Scripture. But I was raised by a redneck, and I was raised in a southern New Mexico town called El Paso. And in that way of growing up, you learn that all truth in life can be found in the lyrics of a country and western song and verified by Scripture. And so if you were able to hear the song, I want to read a few key verses, because some of us were not able to get back in quickly enough. Some of us will be watching later on video, and I don't think we have rights to broadcast that song. But the song is "There Goes My Life" by Kenny Chesney. Tessa warned me that Kenny Chesney is too pretty for church, and everyone would be distracted. But it begins, "All I could think about was, I'm just too young for this. Got my whole life ahead. Heck, I'm just a kid myself. How am I going to raise one?" All he could see were his dreams going up in smoke. So much for ditching this town and hanging out on the coast. There goes my life. There goes my everything. There goes my future. Might as well kiss it all goodbye. And a couple years of up all night and a few thousand diapers later, that mistake he thought he'd made covers up the refrigerator. And it goes on to be the greatest love of his life as his daughter leaves for school. And he said, "There goes my life." What he thought was a mistake was now the whole meaning behind his life. And that is the story of Joseph, right? Our goal today is to bring Joseph out of the plastic nativity scene and out of the traditional church setting where you see him as a kid covered in blankets in a school play, and actually think of Joseph as a real guy who's dealing with things that real guys deal with today, and gals, but really to relate to him and see what we can pull from his life. There's not a lot written about it in Scripture. We're going to cover a few verses. There's a few others that we'll allude to. But at the end of the day, he's a guy facing an unexpected pregnancy. And he has a plan, and now it's gone. He had a future, and it's not going to work. And his fiancée has just told him that she's pregnant, and he knows it's not his. Does he believe her? Would you? Does he keep her? What would people say? Does he dump her? That's not his plan either. Is there a good way out? So we're going to lean into this today, and we're also going to pass this back and forth a little bit. And part of trying to bring Joseph to life is, I hope that every time you find yourself snapping to that figure in a nativity scene, you'll stop and try and imagine one of your friends who's gone through something like this, or is going through something like this, or a time when you went through something like this. And let's not make this about somebody who lived on dirt roads 2,000 years ago, but let's think about our friends here in Albuquerque and Rio Rancho who this applies to. To help with that, we're not going to be high church at all. We're going to toss this back and forth between Dan and I. Hope to have it very conversational. And honestly, in First Church, this was much like the process of preparing, where we sat at Starbucks and tossed it back and forth. And I hope you'll join the conversation and think about Joseph and see if we can't find a way that his story applies to ours. So Dan, would you help us get in context?
Cool. Yeah, so we wanted to start by just looking a little bit at who Joseph was, a little pre-Mary and when they first got together. And so here we have a guy who's in a mess, but he's not responsible for his mess. Which to me is the thing that bugs me more than anything else. It's one thing to get pulled over for speeding. It's one thing to get pulled over for speeding when I don't think I was speeding, right? We would guess that Mary would be in her mid-teens. He would be in his late teens, maybe as old as early 20s, but likely late teens, and her in her mid-teens. He's an insignificant kid in an insignificant town. He's a blue-collar worker. He's not way up working in the synagogue or in the temple in Jerusalem. He's from this place called Nazareth, and people ask later, well, can anything good come from there? In fact, it was until recently one reason that people said you couldn't trust the Bible, because Nazareth wasn't around during the time of Christ. Well, lo and behold, now what did we find? We found both a graveyard just outside of town and homes from the time of Christ during the time of Joseph. So now we realize, oh, we can trust the Bible. But with that, we've also learned that it was a village of maybe 500 people. So he's a little no-name guy in a little no-name village working on chairs. Probably didn't go too far from home, probably didn't care to. And we learn from verse 19 that he was faithful to the law. Your translation might say righteous. For me, I kind of wrote in my margin there, he's by the book. Because faithful to the law is a really good translation. He knew the book and he was faithful to it, is what that phrase means in the Greek. He probably like Chick-fil-A, he probably closed on the Sabbath. He was careful who he hung around. He was careful what food he ate. He kept all the rules and all the traditions probably as well. Another thing that we thought was kind of interesting looking at him is he believed these dreams right away, and we're trying to wrap our heads around that because there's been really 400 years of kind of silence from God, at least nothing, no revelation written. And it's our theory that he believes the dreams that come to him for a couple of reasons. One of those reasons is because he was faithful to the law. And he knew the God who wrote the scriptures at times, it was rare, but at times communicated directly with people. And he had communicated specifically with the other Joseph, the Joseph from the Old Testament. And he had communicated to the Joseph of the Old Testament through dreams. So, and if my name was Joseph, that's a character that I'd read about, right? The other thing that I think is important is when he has a dream, the angel in the dream quotes to him from the book of Isaiah. And it's this weird kind of passage in the context. It's talking to Ahaz, Isaiah is, and there's this little time in there when he says, well, you need to pick a sign. And the king says, no, I don't want to pick a sign. He says, well, okay, I'm going to give you a sign. A virgin's going to conceive and bear a son. You're going to call him Emmanuel. So this weird, obscure little passage, I think Joseph knew. And that's why when he has the dream and the angel in the dream quotes scripture, he says, ah, maybe it's more than bad pizza. Because I don't know about you, but I haven't had many figures and dreams quoting the Bible to me. So he's able, because he's in the book, back up a little bit. This is a way subpoint kind of from our main theme, but I don't want us to miss it. God's able to communicate with Joseph supernaturally because Joseph has already been in the Word of God. I don't know that God could have passed that message any other way. In fact, I would go so far as to say that I would bet that the reason that was put in the Scripture 700 years ago was just so Joseph would know it and Joseph would believe the dream. If we want to hear from God, if we want to follow God, if we want to be in his story for our lives, we've got to be in the Word, or he's going to struggle to speak to us. We need his Word in there. Anyway, I wasn't supposed to give that sermon, but I threw it in anyway. Okay, and then finally, because he was by the book, it says there that he was pledged, and what this means, if you're not familiar with the story, is he was more than engaged. So your version might say engaged, that's the closest thing we have to it, but he was more than engaged, he was pledged or betrothed in the King James Version. And so what that meant was he went to his parents and said, what do you think about Mary? And she went to hers, and what do you think about Joseph? And the parents okayed it. When I am dictator, arrange marriages. All for me? Yes. So parents were good with it. They got together. There's a contract written, a marriage contract. The marriage contract is signed. He pays money for her. So he has done that, and he is expecting now to build a honeymoon chamber. We don't know how far he is in completing that, but it's a room on the side of Dad's house, and he's probably buying a house, you know, across town, which in Nazareth would have been like a street and a half away, for them to live in later. But he's building this honeymoon chamber. When he gets done with that, he and his friends are going to go over to Mary's house. They're going to have this big parade down the street when they go to the honeymoon chamber. Then they're going to have this big wedding reception. Oh, he's got all these plans because that's the tradition. And in a town of 500, that's a big deal. So that's where this kid is. And then he gets a surprise. And I'm convinced his question in his head isn't, do I dump her, but it's, how do I dump her? Because righteous guys didn't marry pregnant girls. So we're in Matthew 1, verse 18. It says, this is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. But knowing that backstory, isn't that just a crazy sentence? It came about through these two kids. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant by the Holy Spirit. By the way, during this time of pledging, because they're legally married, if Joseph dies, she's a widow. If she gets pregnant, then he has a choice of divorcing her privately or divorcing her publicly or stoning her, according to Old Testament law. Now, the Romans frowned without them throwing rocks, so they didn't do the stoning anymore, but he can divorce her privately or publicly. So we thought, how did she convey the message? We decided it was good news and bad news, Joseph. The good news is, you're righteous and I'm righteous. The bad news is, I'm pregnant and you're not dad. And then, like Clay asked, did you believe it? And of course not. Now, there is this tendency to say, I can still be righteous, in quotes. I can still be following the law. And I can rub her nose in it. I can look good. In fact, the more I put her down, the more righteous I look. Because look what she did to me. So we decided if it happened today, this would be her Facebook post. His Facebook post. I just want y'all to know that who Mary really is, and you can come down to your own conclusions. I'm done with the tramp. If y'all want the truth, just hit me up. If you don't like this post, go ahead and unfriend me. I know who my real fans are. Anyway, LOL. But we've seen those posts, right? We've wanted to post them ourselves. Maybe we have posted them ourselves. I believe Joseph, although he's in the story of God, is as much a knucklehead as I am. And as a human, he wants to post something like that. There's a part of you that wants to say, look, I'm righteous. I can't believe you did this. Good grief. Wait till my friends. I'm going to go tell. And there's a part of you, isn't there? Or am I the only one that's that messed up? I get this look and it's like, okay, maybe you don't go there. And he can divorce her publicly and rub her nose in it and still be okay by the law. But if he does that, he's going to be out of the story of God. It may be okay by the law, but he's going to be out of the story of God. When Ronaldo found out I was talking on Joseph, he gave me a line that came to him, which is just, you know a good man by the way he treats a woman. I think we could broaden that to say, you know a good man or a good person because they're gracious. Everything may be lawful, but everything's not profitable. So verse 19 says, and Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law because her husband was faithful to the law and yet didn't want her to expose her to public disgrace. He said, no, I'm not going to do that. I love this girl. I'm dumping her, but I'm not going to disgrace her. So he had in mind to divorce her quietly, and that word means secretively. I'm going to make this as quiet under the radar as I can do it. I'm not going to drag her through it. And so one of our ideas, one of our main points in this sermon is simply to live with grace over law, with grace over tradition, to be gracious rather than disgrace. 1 Peter 3:18, we're commanded in a present imperative to continually grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You know, it's one thing to grow in knowledge. Sometimes it's harder to grow in grace because that very often is the application of the knowledge. The Pharisees grew in knowledge. They didn't grow in grace. Joseph has knowledge at this point. He's a person of the law. He knows it. He's righteous. The question is he going to apply it? Is he going to grow in grace? What does grace mean? Joy-giving. Is he going to give Mary joy? Or is he going to post? There's a line I'd like you to write down if you're taking notes. It's not going to be on the PowerPoint, but we felt it was key to the talk, kind of last minute. And here it is. We have to let go of the life we planned to get the life God has waiting for us. We've got to let go of what we planned. That was the video. That's Joseph's life. So our main point then is deeper righteousness. It's not just being right, but there's a deeper righteousness we need to go to. Not just knowledge of the law, but applying it in grace. Even if we should suffer for what is right, we are blessed when we're in the story of God. That's what it's all about.
So all my mom's family lives in the East Mountains, and if you go out through Chillilee and the road dead ends and you take a right towards Mountain Air and you go through Torreon, then you go through Tahique, they live there. And so when I read Nazareth, I think Tahique. And they don't have a school there. They all go to school in Mountain Air. And so that's, you know, that's how close the community is. It's everybody knows everybody. Everybody knows everybody's business. And Joseph has just been faced with, am I going to put her out and disgrace her? Or am I going to quietly put her away and show her grace? And he passed the test, right? Passed the test. So this is the part where God says, good job, Joseph. You passed the test. You're in the story. Let's read on.
Now for something harder.
Matthew 1:20. After he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Okay. After he considered it, I think that timing stinks. I mean, Mary came to him and said, look, this is a baby of the Holy Spirit. I have not been unfaithful. And no angel came then. And then he considered it. I don't know if he considered it for a weekend or a week or a month, but he considered it and he wrestled with it and he thought through all of the implications of, well, if I take her as my wife, then I'm the guy who cheated on my engagement and, you know, messed up and went early. I'm going to miss all the cool stuff. If I put her away, then I'm missing out on this girl that I love, but at least people will think well of me. And I've wrestled through it and I've come to what I think is a gracious decision. He could have come during the considering, right? But he comes after he's considered it, after he's actually decided what he's going to do. All right, so back in the scripture. Matthew 1:20. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. And all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. That's pretty crazy, right? He considered this. He wrestled with it. He came to a decision. He's about to tell her what his decision is. The next morning, maybe, he has a dream. The angel comes to him. He's convinced by the angel quoting scripture that this is real. And the very next day, he takes Mary as his wife. He obeys right away. And he doesn't even sleep with her for the next 9 months. You got either an older teenager or a young man who's living with this woman that he's thought about for a long time, that he's pledged himself to, that he's given money for, that he's prepared for, and yet he doesn't even consummate the marriage for 9 months. That's a lot of self-control. So I'm going to lean into a few questions, but the first one's really hard. And the first one is, why did God wait until after he considered it? And because I don't know, let's ask Dan.
So I'm convinced there's something, this will be in my theology book, called the ministry of mess. And that if you and
See, if I said that, it sounds silly.
But if you and I give up the life God, that we have for us, our plans for our life, and we go to the life that God has planned for us, then our life is going to be messy. Because I believe the way we grow, the way we change, the way we really get close to God is through the ministry of mess. And how many times have we looked at God and said, God, just write it in the sky, give me a letter, tell me what to do, I just want to know. And God says, no, I think I'm going to wait a little while until you stew on it. That's the ministry of mess, because it's the stewing on it. It's the going around in our gut. It's the spending time with God. It's the looking into the scripture that really is what, that's what results in our growth. I don't know who Joseph would have ended up being without this ministry of mess, but I'm convinced he was a better, deeper man in the story of God because of the ministry of mess. God doesn't do that just to give Joseph a hard time. It's not because he's mean. It's not because God needs a watch. It's because he wants to develop something in Joseph that's not going to be developed unless he has to wrestle with that. We find it throughout Scripture. We find it with Abraham. We find it with Moses. God doesn't give him plans very far ahead. You know, he tells Abraham, you know, get together your family and your camels and your donkeys and everything and go to a place I'm going to show you. Doesn't even tell him where he's going. He just says, start packing. So many times we want things lined out down the road and we struggle, and that's when it's hard, but that's when God's working in our heart. That's when we get close to him. It's in those times of difficulties in the ministry of mess. So I want you to know, I don't want to give you a bait and switch here. I believe that we all need to let go of the life we plan to get the life that God has waiting for us. But I want you to know, when we do that, we're going to go through mess. It's not easy, because it's in the uneasy times that God works in us. It's in the uneasy times that we get somewhere with him. In fact, I wrote in my notes, discombobulated. You ever remember that word? Discombobulated. That's when God does something. So that's when he has to figure out, am I going to be gracious or am I going to do legal revenge? Because it's revenge, but it is legal. And then, you know, am I going to obey this dream? Because I can say, well, it was just a dream, right? I've got a way out. Am I going to obey this dream? Or am I going to look good? Because it's tempting to look good.
So kind of summarizing that, you know, Joseph understood that it was more important to be righteous than to look righteous. He valued obedience over appearance. He would have looked much better if he had put her away, if he had condemned the pregnancy, affirmed his innocence in the pregnancy, and put her away. He probably could have found another fiance, started the dream again, gotten back on the path, gotten his dreams going back forward. He could have gotten his life back, right? But by taking her home, he's going to miss that big parade through Tahike with all of his friends and family. He's going to miss the party and the big wedding. He's going to miss the honeymoon suite that he's built. He's going to miss all that. And instead, he's going to be the guy that people whisper about at the football game in Estancia and say, you know, he had no self-control, or even worse, his wife's a tramp and he's weak and can't confront her on it, right? He's going to be the one you think he's going to be invited to be an elder in the church now? Probably not. So he felt that it was more important to be righteous than to appear righteous, okay? Let's even think about that whole thing of not consummating for 9 months. Now he had taken Mary as his wife. There was nothing wrong with him consummating the marriage and being with her. But he believed that this was a child of the Holy Spirit, that this was the Messiah to come, and he believed it was not his to take until that was done. I mean, that's amazing self-control. Now, not many of us are going to be able to apply that lesson. So how do we apply that to our lives? You know, shallow righteousness is appearing righteous. Deep righteousness is being righteous. How many of you are either dealing with students or patients or employees or some group that you owe some debt of confidentiality to, some duty of confidentiality? Okay. Most of the adults, some of the children. I hope you can relate to this, but I deal with this all of the time. It is very common. I work in healthcare, and I'm in a leadership position. It's very common that I'll have a leader or an employee who gets on the wrong side of the rules, and we'll try very hard to restore them. And we'll give them second chances. We might move them around. We might change their duties. We might get them a coach. We might mentor them. We might all kinds of things we might do. And sometimes it still doesn't work out. And there's nothing worse than when you've worked with someone for 6 months and you've given them every chance and afforded them every opportunity, and then they get mad and leave and tell everybody what a jerk you are and how unfair you are, right? Have you been there? Has it happened to you with friends? Has it happened with, it's happened in a lot of ways. And what do you want to do? You have this need deep inside you to set the record straight. You want to yell from the rooftops. You want to put it on blast that that person is lying and you gave them every chance and they are a screwed up mess. And I mean, can I say that in church? I know. So,
no, you got to take it back now.
Okay, I take it back. So you want so bad to set it right, but you have this duty of confidentiality. And they have none. They're an individual speaking their mind and you don't say anything. And you let it go. And you trust your reputation to your past actions, to your future actions, to your record, to your character, to your God. And you recognize you don't have to correct everything that's been put out there. Not everything that happens in this world deserves a tweet in response, right? And that's a deeper righteousness, is to know that it's better to be righteous than to attack and appear righteous. It's better to be righteous and know that your name's going to be tossed around a little bit than to jump out into the fray so you can appear righteous. So the story of Joseph goes on beyond these verses, but not much. He's mentioned by name, but not in person. When they say, isn't that Joseph's son, the carpenter's son? He's mentioned once when Jesus is 12 years old and his parents, Mary and Joseph, take him to celebrate the Passover in Jerusalem. And he stays behind and they have to leave the caravan and go back and find him. And that's the last time he's mentioned in Scripture. There's some histories and some apocryphal writings where he's mentioned, but that's the last time he's mentioned in Scripture, is sometime around when Jesus is 12 years old. So I want to reflect on Joseph's life, that he is someone who knew the Word, who was faithful to the law, who was also merciful, who believed God when God spoke, who obeyed immediately, who put being right better than appearing right. And yet, he didn't get protection or long life or blessings. In fact, when he went to have to participate in the census and he had to go to Bethlehem with his very pregnant wife, God didn't even provide a room for him in the end, right? All this right decision making, and God didn't even arrange for him to have a comfortable place for Mary to give birth. They had to go to a barn. He shows up and immediately finds out that the head of the government, Herod, is out to get him and is going to slaughter children until he finds this baby that Mary's given birth to. And so he has to flee. God doesn't protect him from persecution. There goes his life again. All of a sudden he's hiding out in Egypt. He finally comes back from hiding and he's blessed with being in the story of God and getting to raise God's very son and see these miracles. But he disappears sometime after Jesus' 12th birthday. Mary's probably widowed. When it comes to the time of the cross, Jesus looks from the cross, says to John, "Behold your mother, mother, behold your son." Joseph's not around anymore. What Joseph understood, though, is that he was 100% committed to obedience and 0% invested in the outcome. 100% committed to obedience and 0% invested in the outcome. We've used that phrase before, but it's important. Doing what's right allows you to be part of the story of God, period, and that's enough. It doesn't mean you'll be wealthy. It doesn't mean you'll have long life. It doesn't mean your diseases will be cured. It just means you'll be part of the story of God, and what a great feeling that is.
Okay, and then the other, we got three kind of principles to bring up here. The other one was what we talked about earlier, grace over law or grace over tradition. And let me say that sometimes in church, if you're someone who's been churched a long time, it can feel like being gracious is being weak or being shallow. Think how Jesus was criticized. He's eating with tax collectors. He's eating with prostitutes. He's healing on the Sabbath. And you know what the Pharisees said. They said, well, okay, you know, what kind of follower of God is this? He should be correcting the tax collectors. They're ripping people off. He should be straightening out the prostitutes. They need to find another line of work. And what's he doing healing on the Sabbath? Why doesn't he ask them to come back tomorrow and then heal them? But what's Jesus doing? Well, he's putting grace over the tradition and grace over some of the laws, because grace is what comes first. Jesus would have looked better if he hadn't healed on the Sabbath. He would have looked better if he hadn't eaten with those people. But that's what he's called us to do. That Karenette over here, so we're going to have all these gifts, and they're going to go off to these families, and we're going to eat together on Friday night, and we want to bless them. And Karenette's idea, I mean, their bottom line is to try to save babies. But if a mom decides not to save her unborn child, it doesn't mean that we're not going to bless her anyway. We bless because that's what God asks us to do. Because grace is a cornerstone of Christianity. We had a guy start coming to our church in Winnipeg, and we were a downtown church, so you get all kinds, right? And some of them are difficult to deal with. We had some that were coming that were self-proclaimed prophets and wanted to stand up and start quoting scripture and knocking dirt off of their sandals if we didn't let them. But one guy came for a while, and I still remember he would wear a black trench coat. And a lot of people wore big coats, but he wouldn't take it off. He wore it all the time. And then after the service, he ended up talking to some of the cuter girls in the church or who were in the band, and it was kind of creepy. And so, can I say kind of creepy to about people in the church? Anyway, he's coming a while, and I mean, you want to be open, but anyway. So I talked to this guy who's got a downtown church who's just very into downtown ministry and working with folks, and I asked him, I said, now, you know, how do you deal with this kind of thing? What do you do? Because I'm new to this kind of ministry. And he said, oh, Dan, he said, make sure you don't leave them alone. Those are the people you smother. He said, have leaders, have elders on either side of them. Invite them over to your house. Invite them over to lunch. Love the fool out of this guy. And if he wants help, you'll be able to help. If he doesn't want help, he'll run like crazy to Calvary down the road. So, but, you know, when he first says, oh, Dan, I realize, oh, gosh, I'm missing it. I'm a pastor. I ought to be about grace first. You know, I was concerned about caring for my flock, but I wasn't as concerned about that guy. And so it is pouring into that guy. And he did run away, but if he hadn't have, we would have poured into him just like this. It doesn't always look as good, but it's right. Clay brought out, when we were first going over this, he went ahead and read the whole first chapter, and it starts with all the genealogies. And he said, oh, did you notice all the women in the genealogies and this and that? I said, yeah, that's really interesting. And I want to say, I skipped the genealogies and went to Joseph. But went back through the genealogies and looked at the women in the genealogies, and it starts with Tamar, who dressed up and posed as a prostitute to seduce her father-in-law. And then the next woman in the line of Christ is Rahab, who didn't have to dress the part because she was the part. Then we have Ruth, who's a Moabite, which may not mean much to us, but she's from a land where that got started because of Lot and his daughter. The next one listed is Bathsheba. And Dave gets most blame for the Dave and Bathsheba thing, King David, and he should. He was the king, and he asked her over. But I don't know that he would have asked her over if she had decided to close the blinds. Seems to me there was a two-way street there. But these people, and everybody in the line of Christ is messed up, but these specific women that Matthew includes in there is for a purpose, so that we could identify and say, hey, we are all messed up. We all need help. We need the grace of God in our lives. And because the grace of God has taken me from just being a mess and washing away my sin and giving me a new direction so I can love others, so that they can know this Jesus who washes away sin and gives a new direction. It's not that we push people away. We want to love them into the kingdom. And so it may look weak, but it is right. It is grace before law, and it's redemption, because that's what the scripture is about.
So we've watched this young woodworker out of Tahike and watched what he did when he was faced with an unexpected pregnancy that derailed his life plans. And we've observed that he's 100% committed to obedience and not 0% worried about the outcome. We've observed that that he learned that you put grace over law. And we've learned that he was committed to obedience over appearance. Jesus grew up with Joseph being his earthly father. And Jesus watched this type of grace and righteousness that's at a deeper level in action. And so later, so he knew that Joseph was willing to be seen as unrighteous precisely because he was righteous. Jesus was willing to be seen as unrighteous precisely because he was righteous. And having had that role model and being filled with the Spirit, Jesus later said in Matthew 5, "For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven." So the teachers of the law and the Pharisees were the epitome of pursuing the appearance of righteousness. Right? They bound the scriptures to their foreheads. They walked around in robes. They, held counsel all the time. Everything they did was about eating the right things and observing the right festivals. And Jesus wasn't impressed. That wasn't what it was about. I was privileged to grow up in several different faith traditions. I was raised in a Methodist church in El Paso, and then went off to school and was part of a Disciples of Christ, United Church of Christ, and Presbyterian ministry called United Campus Ministries. And that was both of those were very liberal traditions, very involved in social justice. Most of the congregation would vote Democrat, really into expanding the welfare state, making sure there were options for the downtrodden. And then we went off to Dallas, we're part of a Bible Fellowship church, and off to Kentucky, where you could either be Baptist or Catholic, so we were Baptist. And both of those were really, really conservative traditions where almost everyone voted Republican, right? And the gospel was very, very mixed with your politics and with, the platform of a certain party. Between those, I got to go do mission work in Mexico. And in Mexico, I was part of a ministry that was pretty mixed but had some roots in liberation theology. Had some communist roots and such. In short-term missions, been able to go to Haiti, which is also just interdenominational work. And then here in Albuquerque, you get to be a part of a congregation. I think the official term is mutt, right? mixed, right? We're mixed of all creeds. We're just evangelical. But isn't it crazy how all of these people following the same book and following the same God have different lists of what appearing righteous looks like. What you can't do or you won't be righteous. In Kentucky, my goodness, if you had a glass of wine, you were going straight to purgatory. Well, they didn't believe in purgatory. Hell, you were going to. here, we have beer with members of our life group and hang around the pool, and that's just fine, right? Everyone has these catchphrases, and they're not rooted in what Scripture says. They're all rooted in good things and come from good interpretations. But we tend to shun people and condemn people who follow certain lists of rules, and we tend to approve people who follow others. And there's this, we feel compelled. We almost can't resist when someone puts out there that we see a boy who's effeminate, or we see someone who's dressing in a gender inappropriate way, or we see somebody who's gambling, or insert your favorite thing here, but we almost can't resist condemning it. Whether it's a political post or whether it's a lifestyle choice. Whereas if we were doing right instead of being so concerned with the appearance, wouldn't we come alongside those people and have a conversation, invite them to lunch, find out how they came to the positions they're in, find out what's going on in their life and how we could serve or help? Right? Being right over appearing right is something that we learn deeply from the life of Joseph. The application I would ask is for each of you, I would examine those triggers, those things that when you see them posted, whether it's a political post or a lifestyle post or a view on immigration, whatever it is, examine those and think, how much of this comes from my identity as a Christian and my knowledge of Scripture, and how much of this comes from something else? My identity as an American, my identity as a conservative or a liberal, my identity as whatever else. And really, when I feel that compulsion that I must put my voice out there and condemn, or I must put my voice out there and support, is that really the loving and most righteous thing to do? I'll turn it over to you to close.
Okay. So we wanted to look at some consequences of his decision of being in the story of God. First, one pretty negative. He had to wait for Mary to give birth to someone else's kid. Waited for 9 months. But then he got to raise the Son of God. His reputation was gone. Another thing thought about in the whole angel part of the story is, why couldn't the angel have gone to some of his friends and neighbors? But the angel only comes to Joseph. He alone gets the story. He alone knows really what's happened. So his reputation's gone. And in John 8:41, they're having this debate, Jesus and the Pharisees, and basically he's calling them sons of the devil, and he says, you're doing the works of your father. And they respond to him with the emphasis on the word we in the Greek, we aren't illegitimate children. You get where they're going. Reputation followed throughout. His reputation is restored, but not in his lifetime. But it's been restored for the last 2,000 years. It's not too bad. And for eternity. And the last little thought is simply, what if he hadn't obeyed? What if he hadn't obeyed? And he said, no, I'm just going to put you away. And I'm going to sign this bill of divorcement. I suppose Mary would have been a single mom, and Joseph would have missed it. He would have got his plan for his life. Like Clay said, he might have gone and married somebody else, but he would totally miss the greatness of being in the story of God. Deeper righteousness, even if we suffer for doing what's right, we're blessed by being in the story of God. So the question then is, how do we get in the story of God? And the simple answer is, we got to let go of the life we planned. We have to surrender. Got to let go of the life we planned. So that's why we played the song at the beginning, There Goes My Life. And that's our question for you is, are you willing to pray that today? God, I'm going to let go of the life I planned. I'm going to let it go. I want yours. And so I just ask that you'd pray that with me as we close. And then if you would like to pray with someone about that, that you would come on up after the service. We would love to pray with you. But it's a huge request. You're saying, God, I've got these plans for my life. I'm willing to let them go. I want yours. A step at a time, a little bit at a time. I know you won't show me it all, but I want your plans for my life. You stand with me? Heavenly Father, we know the plans that you have for our life are plans of peace and plans of grace. But it doesn't mean they'll be easy. But I believe you were gracious to Joseph. You let him raise your son, that you gave him peace, peace between you and him, peace between he and Mary, peace at home. And Father, you had a fantastic over-the-top plan for his life. I believe that you do for each and every one of us. And so, Father, today we let go, and we will let you take over. In your name we pray. Amen.